नमस्कार। जैसे कि पिछले लेक्चर्स में मैंने इंटरफेरेंस पर के बारे में बताया था, आज मैं उसी श्रृंखला को आगे बढ़ाते हुए डिफ्रैक्शन ऑफ लाइट पर आपको कुछ बातें बताऊंगा। डिफ्रैक्शन ऑफ लाइट, जैसा कि इसकी डेफिनेशन है, डिफ्रैक्शन इज द फिनोमिना ऑफ बेंडिंग ऑफ लाइट, बेंडिंग ऑफ लाइट राउंड द कॉर्नर्स। इंटरफेरेंस में हमने देखा कि लाइट एक वेव की तरीके से बिहेव करती है, और अगर इसकी एनालॉजी हम साउंड वेव से करें तो हम देखते हैं कि साउंड वेव किनारे से मुड़ती है। उसी प्रकार लाइट यदि वेव है तो उसको भी साउंड की तरीके से बिहेव करना चाहिए। मगर सामान्यतः हम देखते हैं कि लाइट वेव फॉर्म की तरह बिहेव नहीं करती, बल्कि सीधी रेखाओं में चलती है, जैसा कि एक पार्टिकल की ट्रेजेक्ट्री होती है, जिसको जब हम मान लिया कि शैडो देखते हैं किसी ऑब्जेक्ट की, तो हम देखते हैं कि शैडो इस तरीके से बनती है जैसे कि प्रकाश सीधी रेखाओं में चल रहा हो। इन्हीं पर आधारित है जैसे सूर्य ग्रहण या चंद्र ग्रहण या किसी भी तरीके की ज्योमेट्रिकल शैडो हम देखते हैं, वो रेक्टिलिनियर प्रोपोगेशन ऑफ लाइट को ही सपोर्ट करती है। इसका मतलब सामान्यतः हम देखते हैं कि लाइट सीधी रेखाओं में चलता है, जबकि वेव थ्योरी के हिसाब से ये आवश्यक है। अगर साउंड एक वेव की तरीके बिहेव करती तो साउंड को एंड्स पर मुड़ना चाहिए। तो जैसे कि डेफिनेशन है, द बेंडिंग ऑफ लाइट एट द एज ऑफ एन ऑब्स्टेकल एंड हेंस इट्स इंक्रोचमेंट इनटू द रीजन ऑफ ज्योमेट्रिकल शैडो इज नोन एज डिफ्रैक्शन ऑफ लाइट। अब हमें एक ऐसा मॉडल बनाना पड़ेगा जिसमें कि हम ये तो देखें कि लाइट बेंड करती है या कर सकती है, लेकिन साथ ही हमें यह भी प्रूफ करना पड़ेगा जिससे कि हम ये प्रूफ कर सके कि नॉर्मल केसेस में लाइट इस तरीके से बिहेव करती है जैसे कि ये एक सीधी रेखा में चलती है या इसका प्रोपोगेशन जो है वो रेक्टिलिनियर है। तो सबसे पहले फ्रेनल ने इसके लिए कुछ एजम्पशंस बनाए, और इन एजम्पशंस को हम ये कह सकते हैं, जैसे लाइट अगर वेव के फॉर्म में चलती है तो लाइट एक वेव फ्रंट बनाएगी, जैसा कि इस फिगर में हम देखते हैं। एक सोर्स एस है, एस सोर्स से निकली वेव जब आगे बढ़ेगी तो किसी पर्टिकुलर समय में एक वेव फ्रंट बनाएगी। माना कि ऐसे एक पॉइंट सोर्स ऑफ लाइट है तो उसके द्वारा बना हुआ वेव फ्रंट स्फेरिकल होगा, जिसको कि हम टू डायमेंशंस में एक सर्कुलर फॉर्म में देखते हैं। इसका एक पर्टिकुलर टाइम में इसका कोई एक रेडियस होगा जो कि एस पी के बराबर होगा, और सारे पॉइंट्स वेव फ्रंट के किसी पर्टिकुलर टाइम में एस पी के बराबर रेडियस पर चारों तरफ डिस्ट्रीब्यूट होंगे। अब इस वेव फ्रंट में तो फ्रेनेल ने अज्यूम किया कि द इफेक्ट ऑफ एट एनी पॉइंट ओ, माना कि कोई पॉइंट ओ है जो कि कुछ दूरी पर है एस से, तो यहां पर जो कंट्रीब्यूशन होगा वो सारे पॉइंट्स वेव फ्रंट के जितने भी पॉइंट्स हैं इन सब का कंट्रीब्यूशन ओ पॉइंट पर आएगा। मतलब कि वेव फ्रंट का हर पॉइंट सेकेंडरी वेवलेट्स जेनरेट करेगा और वो वेवलेट्स तब समय के साथ आगे बढ़ते हुए ओ पॉइंट पर पहुंचेंगे, जिसको कि हम सर्कुलर फॉर्म में ये ओ पॉइंट पर पहुंचे। तो जो जो वेव फ्रंट के पी पॉइंट से पहुंचेगा वो भी ऊपर पहुंचेगा, जो पी वन पॉइंट से पहुंचेगा वो भी ऊपर पहुंचेगा। तो हमें जो ओ पॉइंट पर जो रिजल्टेंट एम्पलीट्यूड या रिजल्टेंट इंटेंसिटी मिलेगी वो सम होगी सारे वेव फ्रंट के सारे पॉइंट्स का जो रिजल्टेंट ओ पर पहुंचेगा उसका। अब पी या पी डैश से जो भी एम्पलीट्यूड ओ पॉइंट पर पहुंचेगा वो बराबर नहीं होगा, बल्कि डिपेंड करेगा कि पी और पी पॉइंट वेव फ्रंट के किस पार्ट में है। अगर थीटा इज इक्वल टू जीरो है, मतलब पी पॉइंट पर पी ओ अगर हम लें तो थीटा इज इक्वल टू जीरो है, तो थीटा इज इक्वल टू जीरो के लिए जो वेव मूव करेगी वो वेव फ्रंट की से जो स्क्रीन के परपेंडिकुलर डायरेक्शन में मूव कर रही है, और यहाँ पर सबसे अधिक एम्पलीट्यूड उस पार्ट का होगा जो कि पी से पहुंच रहा है। जैसे जैसे कोण बढ़ेगा, माना कि पी वन पॉइंट पर कोण थीटा वन है, तो जैसे जैसे कोण बनेगा बढ़ेगा ओ पॉइंट पर पहुंचने वाला एम्पलीट्यूड कम होता चला जाएगा। व्हेन थीटा इज इक्वल टू 90 डिग्री आई नो दैट कॉस थीटा इज इक्वल टू जीरो एंड द इफेक्ट इन ए डायरेक्शन परपेंडिकुलर टू द नॉर्मल, जो भी जो पॉइंट्स नॉर्मल की डायरेक्शन में होंगे उनका जो रिजल्ट होगा वो जीरो होगा। और अगर मान लिया थीटा इज इक्वल टू 180 डिग्री है, मतलब कि जो वेव फ्रंट का हिस्सा बैकवर्ड डायरेक्शन में मूव कर रहा है, बैकवर्ड डायरेक्शन में इसका एम्पलीट्यूड जीरो होगा, जिससे हम ये अस्यूम कर सकते हैं कि वेव फ्रंट सिर्फ फॉरवर्ड डायरेक्शन में मूव कर रहा है, बैकवर्ड डायरेक्शन में मूव नहीं कर रहा। एक जनरल फॉर्मूला हम इसके लिए यूज करते हैं कि जो रिजल्टेंट किसी भी पॉइंट पर होगा वो होगा 1 प्लस कॉस थीटा अपॉन 2। सो वी कैन सी व्हेन थीटा इज इक्वल टू 0 कॉस थीटा इज इक्वल टू 1, सो 1 प्लस कॉस थीटा अपॉन 2 विल बी इक्वल टू 1 एंड इट विल हैव मैक्सिमम एम्पलीट्यूड। एज थीटा इंक्रीजेस 1 प्लस कॉस थीटा विल डिक्रीज एंड देयरफॉर द एम्पलीट्यूड विल डिक्रीज। व्हेन थीटा इज इक्वल टू 90 डिग्री इट विल बी 1/2, दैट मीन्स at the points situated at 90 degree will contribute half of the points which are situated at 0 degree and there is no backward propagation because when theta is equal to 180 degree 1 plus cos theta by 2 will be equal to 0 and there will be no effect in the direction opposite to the direction of the wave. Now how to divide the wave front? Fresnel divided the wave front in the form as shown in the figure. Suppose there is in the rectangle shown is the plane wave front at any point in the space, and there is contribution at the point O by each part of the wave front. Now Fresnel divided the wave front into a large number of zones which are called Fresnel half period zone. The distance PO of the first half period zone is considered to be from the center point P and the distance from P is equal to B. Then there is another point, say M1. The M1 is such that the distance M1O, this is equal to B1 plus lambda by 2, means the distance increases by lambda by 2, where lambda is the wavelength of light used. Similarly, we can divide it into a large number of half period zones, B plus lambda by 2, B plus 2 lambda by 2 and B plus N lambda by 2. And therefore, we have OM1 is equal to B plus lambda by 2, OM2 is equal to B plus 2 lambda by 2, OM3 is equal to this and so on. So the Nth will be B plus N lambda by 2. Now, Fresnel assumed that the amplitude of the wavelet at the point O depends on the following factors. The amplitude at the point O is directly proportional to the area of the zone. हर एक जोन का फर्स्ट जोन सेकंड जोन थर्ड जोन जिस तरीके से हमने इनको डिवाइड किया तो उनके एरिया पर डिपेंड करेगा. द एम्पलीट्यूड फॉल्स ऑफ इनवर्सली एज द स्क्वायर ऑफ द डिस्टेंस ऑफ द जोन फ्रॉम द पॉइंट ओ. जितनी दूर पर जोन स्थित होगा उससे जो एम्पलीट्यूड पड़ रहा है वो डिस्टेंस के स्क्वायर के इनवर्सली प्रपोर्शनल होगा. The amplitude varies with the obliquity factor, which we have seen already, and this is proportional to 1 plus cos theta by 2. Now, if we go back to the picture, as we have seen, the radius of the first half period zone is PM1, which is equal to OM1 square minus OP square, and which will be equal to b plus lambda by 2 whole square minus b square to the power half. And now we extend it, expand it, and we get PM1 is equal to b square plus lambda square by 4 minus b lambda minus b square by 4. So now b squares cancel out. Lambda is very small quantity with respect to b because this is the wavelength of light, so it can be neglected, and we get this is equal to square root of b lambda. So we see that the radius of the first zone is b lambda. Similarly, the radius of the second half period zone is square root of 2 b lambda, and the radius of the nth half period zone will be square root of n b lambda. So we see that the radius of the successive half period zones is proportional to the square root of the natural numbers. Now we calculate the area of the individual half period zone. The area of the nth zone will be equal to the area of the first n zones minus the area of the first n minus 1 zones. So this will be pi pm pi r square minus pi r2 square, that is pi pm n square minus pm n minus 1 square, and this is equal to pi b lambda. So we see that the area of each half period zone is equal. So it means that we have divided the entire wavefront into a number of half period zones having equal area, which is equal to pi b lambda. Now this depends upon the b, the distance. Area of the half period zone will depend upon the distance of between the wavefront and the point of observation O. So the equation shows that the area of the nth zone is independent of the zone number, and the area of each and every zone is a constant independent of the zone number. The radii of the zones are proportional to n to the power half. So in this way we have divided the entire half period zone, wavefront into a number of half period zones of equal area and the radii depending upon the square root of the natural numbers. So these are called the half period zones. Now what about the amplitudes of the half period zones? As we have seen that the first half period zone, which is situated at the closest point from the point of observation O, and therefore the amplitude of the first half period zone will be highest. As we go successively towards the half period, the higher half period zones, second, third, fourth, and so on, then the amplitude of the half period zones will decrease. We can just average out in a manner that the half period zone M, this M2 will be equal to M1 plus M3 by 2, and similarly M4 is equal, can be approximated to M3 plus M5 by 2, and so on. So they are increasing regularly the amplitude of the successive half period zones is decreasing regularly. Now, what is the resultant of the entire wavefront? As we have divided into the different half period zones. Now, the first half period zone, for the first half period zone, the part difference from the wavefront to the wavefront to the point O, that is equal to M1, and M1 is the highest. The second half period zone, which is situated at a distance of B plus lambda by 2, means we know that the path difference of lambda by 2 corresponds to destructive interference. Therefore, this half period zone is in opposite phase to the first half period zone. Similarly, the third half period zone will be in opposite phase with respect to the fourth half period zone, and so on. So the resultant means that if R1 is the amplitude or F1 is the amplitude of the first half period zone, then the amplitude of the second half period zone will be minus F2. And the third and the first and the third are is in phase again, because the path difference is equal to lambda. So they are in phase. So if we add the amplitudes, the total amplitude will be M1 minus M2 plus M3 minus M4 and so on, plus or last, if it is even, it will be minus Mn, and if it is odd, then it will be plus Mn. And now we can just simplify it in the form M1 by 2 divided plus M1 by 2 and M3 to M1, M3 by 2 plus M3 by 2. And we just see, as in the equation, M1 by 2 plus M1 by 2 minus M2 plus M3 by 2 plus the other factor and so on. Now, as I have already told, that M1 plus M3, M2 is equal to M1 plus M3 by 2. Therefore, the brackets, they will cancel out. They will be, because they will be almost equal to 0, and we get finally A is equal to M1 by 2 plus last term Mn by 2 if Mn is odd, and if Mn is even, this will be M1 plus Mn minus 1 by 2 minus Mn if Mn is odd, is even. So we see that M1 will be very large if there are, if the entire wavefront is divided into a large number half period zones, say 100, then M1 will be much larger than Mn, and therefore the Mn can be neglected, and we get this the total amplitude A, which will be equal to M1 by 2, or the intensity I, that will be equal to square of the amplitude, I is equal to A square, and this will be M1 square by 4. So we can conclude that the resultant in amplitude due to the entire half period zone is equal to half of the amplitude of the first half period zone, and intensity of due to the entire wavefront will be equal to 1 by 4 of the intensity of the first half period zone. So in this way, Fredel divided the entire wavefront into a number of half period zones such that the resultant intensity reaching at any point P will be the equal to half the amplitude of the first half period zone. So the first test of the Fredel's assumption is, why does light travel in straight lines, or that is, why it shows a rectilinear propagation. Now, he explained it with the help of, say, the following diagram. सपोज ए बी सी डी इज ए रेक्टेंगुलर एपर्चर एंड देयर इज ए पैरेलल लाइट बीम एज वी सी ऑन द लेफ्ट साइड ऑफ द पिक्चर विच इज फॉलिंग ऑन ए बी सी डी. नाउ वी टेक डिफरेंट पॉइंट्स से ओ वन ओ टू ओ थ्री ओ फोर ऑन द corresponding to the different rays. O1 is at the middle, O2 is outside the region of the geometrical shadow, O3 is very nearly close to the geometrical shadow, and O4 is somewhat away from the geometrical shadow. So we look into separately into all these cases now. Suppose I take P1, on the light edge it is passing through the aperture and it is falling on a screen. So there is every point on the screen corresponding to every point of the aperture. Let the point P1 is the corresponding to the point O1 of the aperture. We can divide the light falling at the point P will be resultant of all the half period zones which are constructed considering O1 is the locus or the center. So we divide O1 into a large number of half period zones. As we see, O1 is at the center and there will be a large number of half period zones. Because you know that the radius of the first half period zone is equal to under root b lambda. So if b is suppose finite 10 centimeters and lambda is equal to say 5 into 10 to the power minus 5 centimeters, then we have the radius of the first half period zone will be equal to 10 to the power minus 4 centimeters. Square root of that is 10 to the power minus 2 centimeters. The second will be square root of 2 square root of 2 b lambda, that will be equal to square root of 2 into 10 to the power minus 2 centimeters, and so on. So we can see that there will be large number of half period zones which are transparent corresponding to the point P1. And therefore, the resultant amplitude at the point P1 will be equal to M1 by 2, where any point which is close to the point O1 and having large number of half period zones will also have the amplitude equal to M1 by 2. So we see that mostly the large part of the aperture or the large part of the screen that will be uniformly illuminated. Sab ek uniformly illuminate rahega. Now we take another point, O2. The O2 point is in the region of the geometrical shadow. So the locus corresponding to this on the screen is the point P2 is the locus corresponding to point O2 on the screen. As this is outside in the region of geometrical shadow, we see that a large number of half period zones will not transmit. Only the very high number of half period zones, if we draw circles around O2, we will see that almost all the half period zones, the important half period zones, they will be blocked, and because of this blocking we do not see light at the point P2. So the resultant amplitude at the point P2 due to O2 will be almost zero, and therefore the P2 will appear dark. Now we look at the point O3. Suppose it is द रेडियस ऑफ ओ थ्री इज सच दैट इट अलाउज ओनली वन हाफ पीरियड जोन. सो वी सी दैट ओनली वन हाफ पीरियड जोन इज अलाउड टू पास एंड द करस्पॉन्ड एट द पॉइंट पी टी पी थ्री देयर विल बी लाइट कमिंग करस्पॉन्डिंग टू वन हाफ पीरियड जोन ओनली एंड देयर फोर एट द पॉइंट पी थ्री द रिजल्टेंट एम्पलीट्यूड विल बी इक्वल टू एम वन विच करस्पॉन्ड्स टू द एम्पलीट्यूड ऑफ द ऑफ वन हाफ पीरियड जोन. सो पी एट द पॉइंट पी थ्री वी गेट द एम्पलीट्यूड एम वन और द इंटेंसिटी इज इक्वल टू इंटेंसिटी एम वन स्क्वायर. So we see that at the point P3, if it occupies only one half period zone, the intensity will increase in comparison to the intensity P1, which is uniformly illuminated. So there will be a, intensity will increase at the point P3. Suppose O4 is a point which allows two half period zones. So the resultant amplitude at P corresponding to P4 at P4 will be the resultant due to two half period zones, and this will be M1 minus M2. As M1 is almost equal to M2, so the point P4 will be dark in comparison to the uniform illumination. So we see that if it allows one half period zone or three half period zone, the radius is such that one half it allows one half period zone or three half period zones, then we will get the bright points. And if it allows two half period zones or four half period zones or even number of half period zones, then this will be dark. So if we look closely at the edge, we will see a non-uniform distribution. Of course, the separation is, as I said, that will depend up to around 10 to the power minus 2 centimeters. That is 0.1 0.2 millimeter or less. So that means almost all the this wavefront is the portion of the screen is uniformly illuminated, but only at the edges. Therefore, at the edges, therefore will be non-uniformly distributed, and we will get, if you look closely, any shadow, if we look closely into it, then we see that the shadow is not always sharp. It is a bit hazy. And if we look more closely, we will see the points of maximum and minimum intensity. So in this way, Fresnel could explain that, of course, the light shows the phenomena of diffraction. That means it bends round the corners, or the total amplitude at any point is the sum of the contribution due to the entire wavefront. But even for the finite distances, it appears that the light travels in straight lines. So this was the success by which Fresnel could explain the rectilinear propagation of light. I have described it. Now, we have two cases in which we can classify the diffraction phenomena occurring normally. Now, the diffraction phenomena can be observed in the laboratory. Suppose we take a source of light, as I have shown in the first slide. In this one, suppose there is an aperture of finite size and the wavefront is a plane wavefront, that is a parallel beam of light. The aperture is very small. A parallel beam of light, now it passes through the light passes through the aperture and falls on the screen. If the size of the aperture is small, say less than a millimeter or even smaller, when you see that there is a structure formed, we get the center is very bright, having bright intensity and white. But as we go on either side on the screen, we see that then there is no light. But after some distance, we will see again the bright pattern and the dark pattern. And as if we decrease the aperture more and more, we see the width of this diffraction pattern increases. So on the right side, we have shown the amount of the intensity or the intensity distribution. The center, the intensity at the center is maximum, which is seen from the graph, and then there is a minimum, and then there is a secondary maximum, then minimum, secondary minimum, and so on. So we do not get a uniform distribution. We do not get the shape as given by that in the case when light is shows rectilinear propagation. But this is an example where we can say that there is diffraction phenomena occurring. The only condition is that the aperture from of the slit, that should be very small. We can divide or we can classify the diffraction phenomena which we generally see into two parts. The number one is the Fresnel class of diffraction, and the second is Fraunhofer class of diffraction. The difference is that in the Fresnel class of diffraction, when the source and the screen are at finite distance from the obstacle or oblique aperture, so we see a finite distance, both are at finite distance. As suppose we have a lamp and then the aperture and screen placed at half a meter from each other, approximately. Then we will have the Fresnel class of diffraction. In the case of Fraunhofer diffraction, both the source and screen are at infinite distance from the obstacle. So that is, if infinite distance means the light is coming from infinity, that means we are getting a plane parallel beam of light, and a parallel beam of light is passing through the aperture and then it goes to infinity. That means again it becomes almost parallel beam of light. So that is when both source and screen are at infinite distance from the aperture, we have Fraunhofer class of diffraction. Now, what will be the effect? We will have the difference in the type of wavefront. In the case of Fresnel diffraction, the wavefront which we consider, they are either spherical or cylindrical wavefront. Whereas in the case of the Fraunhofer diffraction, we have a plane wavefront. Now, these show the examples of the two different types of wavefronts. On the left side, there is a spherical wavefront in two dimensions. Means the wavefront, suppose the distance is half meter from between the source and the aperture, then the light reaching there will be in the form of a spherical wavefront. Or if the source is not a point source, but in the form of a rod, which we normally get in the laboratory, then we see that the wavefront which is propagating in the forward direction will be in the form of a cylinder. So it will be a cylindrical wavefront. But the third one, which is corresponding to a parallel beam of light. So for a parallel beam of light, the wavefront will be a plane wave front. So these are the two different cases. So in the Fresnel class, we deal with the spherical wave front and the cylindrical wave front. In the case of Fraunhofer class, we deal with the plane wave front. So what are the differences between these? In the spherical wave front, we do not need any lensage. Because both source and the screen are at finite distance. Whereas in the case of Fraunhofer diffraction, we need converging lenses. Suppose a converging lens is placed at the focus of the converging lens is the source. Then the light coming from the source will become parallel after passing through the lens, and therefore we will get a parallel beam of light, and which corresponds to the plane wave front. So in this case, we will get a plane wave front. The fourth one is, wave falling on the obstacle will not be in the same phase, because waves, they are not in the same phase. Why? Because we have, suppose, a point source. All the point source, for a point source, there will be a finite size of the source. And because of the finite size of the source, all the points within the source are not at the same distance from the aperture, and therefore they will not be in the same phase. Whereas the waves falling in the Fraunhofer's case will be in the same phase. Fresnel's diffraction in general case of diffraction, which reduces to Fraunhofer diffraction when the source and the screen are at infinite distances. So basically, there is no difference between the Fresnel class and Fraunhofer class, but it is only the distance which matters. When it becomes infinite, the Fresnel class can be converted into Fraunhofer class. So depending upon these two classes of diffraction, we can design different devices by which we can see sizable diffraction pattern in the laboratory. So we will discuss the two cases separately in the next lectures.